hit a button, Morty. Give me a beat.
Oh, this is a podcast.
I got Jade Omari on tap today. How are you?
I'm doing well.
I appreciate you for coming through.
I appreciate you for having me.
Made it through the hangovers and all of that type of stuff. We're going to rock this one out. Yeah, man, real quick before we get into it, let people know who you are and what you do.
Okay. Well, for those of you that don't know, I go by the name of Jade Omari. I'm an artist from Maryland. I've been doing music for a good 6-7 years now. And I just started taking it serious as a career probably
really?
Like 2 or 3 years ago.
That's crazy.
Yeah, because I used to do it for fun at first. But then after that, I was just like, you know, this is, maybe it could take me somewhere.
That's interesting. I kind of want to start there. Like, what was it that made you think that? Like, what was the shift that made you take it from hobby to let me take this seriously?
I guess it was the feedback I was getting. Mm-hmm. And then also I started hearing the switch of how music was when I was growing up to what it's becoming now. And I felt like music was kind of losing, not its value, but I just felt like it wasn't really, like as far as the industry goes from how it started out until how it is now, it's not as difficult to get into it as it used to be. Like you could do one hit wonder shit and blow up and stuff. So I feel like the quality of the industry is not as great as it used to be.
Just like based off, you can do one hit wonder shit now?
What are you saying?
No.
I'm saying like basically what made me want to do it is because from the music that I used to listen to the music that's here now, I felt like the industry was losing its quality of art.
Mm-hmm.
You get me? Because they're just signing anybody that has numbers. Yeah, okay, it's not about the talent anymore. It's about the numbers.
100%.
So that also played a role in me saying like, okay, maybe I could help, I guess, bring a little bit of real music back.
For sure.
Just based off of the feedback I was getting.
Yeah.
So.
And I feel that because as I was starting to do just a little bit of research on you and stuff like that, I was definitely digging into your music catalog. And that's kind of something that I felt, you know what I'm saying? I told you a little bit earlier that I feel like your music really has substance behind it. You know what I mean? And what's crazy is there was one joint, I think it's called Upside Down.
Yeah.
Dog, I heard that song and I was just like, yeah, like it put me back into a place. You feel me? Like
really?
it made me emotionally like go back to a time. You know what I mean? That song was very hard.
It was difficult, like, cause I had to channel a whole rack of like emotions that I was dealing with and like not be too emotional on the track, but more so where like the point could get across and then also people could relate to it.
And that is very interesting that you say that because I feel like that's something that I notice about your music. It's like it seems to me, and correct me if I'm wrong, but it seems like that's how you go through your emotions is like making, like you go through it through making the music. Is that accurate?
Music has become my diary.
Yeah, in a way. Yeah, for sure.
So it's like, that's why I guess you could say I'm really transparent when it comes to the music. If nobody knows who I am, all you gotta do is listen to my music and
for
you
sure.
can tell like half of my story.
Yeah, for sure. And I feel like, well, I kind of want to go back a little bit.
Go ahead.
If we go back to your childhood, like elementary school, what did you think you were going to be when you grew up?
Honestly, I did want to do music, but I never, like, I kind of fell out of it because I've always been creative ever since I was elementary school. I was really good at poetry. Then I was in a group. It was like a thing that the school had. It was like a, what are those things called? Like, they have chorus, but it's like
what's that shit called? It's not drama club. It's
right.
Like,
well, let's just say it was a program.
Okay.
So there was a program called Colors and Chorus. Mm-hmm. And basically they would dance and stuff, but they would also sing. So like we would go perform at other schools and stuff like that. We'd perform at Northwestern High School, stuff like that. And it felt like, damn, this is fun. I really like this. But then I grew out of it. And I guess that's where like me now, I have like those shy moments because if I would have stayed in it, I feel like if I stayed in it at that age and grew into it, I'd probably be 10 times.
You'd be flexing that performance muscle.
Right.
Like
exactly.
It's crazy because like all that shit is just repetition.
Exactly.
Like you never really lose the nerves. It's just that you get used to the nerves the more you do it. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And I still haven't got used to the nerves because of the fact that I'm so shy or so nervous or whatever. I guess it kind of like, it's that saying that I think Kanye said, he was like, people are so scared to fail that they don't even try. Like
facts.
Sometimes the fear could be that paralyzing, but then it's just like, it's either you do it and maybe fail or you're going to just automatically fail by not doing anything.
Yeah. And you know, what's interesting about that too, is that I feel like once you, there's no ducking failing. You know what I'm saying? There's no ducking failure.
Not at all.
You feel me?
So it's once it,
yeah, but the thing is, to me, it's like the people who become successful are the ones who are not scared of failing, so that they yeah. just put themselves out on the line all the time
yeah.
until eventually someone's like, oh no, this person's not shit. Like, you know, or not even that they're not shit. Like
right.
they're not scared, and they give their gift an opportunity to be seen. You know what I'm saying? Like,
facts.
If no one knows you have a gift because you're too scared to go out there and put it in front of people, then what do you know, nothing's going to happen for you. You know what I'm saying? So it's like
right.
you kind of take yourself out the game before the game's even started. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, and that's what I had to like tell myself, because I was one of those people that was so scared I didn't want to try, because I didn't want to be embarrassed.
Yeah.
Didn't want to, you know, fall on stage or just something dumb, get booed off stage. But then I had to remind myself, okay, Eminem got booed off stage and he's like one of the greatest rappers.
Yeah.
Beyonce fell. Like, Joe's just like the greatest have still.
It's part of it. Like, once you realize that it's part of it, it kind of changes. That's kind of. That happened to me. Like, I had to realize that failure is just part of what I'm trying to do. You know what I mean? It's. What gets you where you want to go is just the continuous movement. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It doesn't matter if it's like forward or backward, honestly. It's just that the fact that you're moving, people see that you're doing something. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
I think that gets lost. You know what I mean? People don't realize that the success really only comes in just like the movement, the doing, just people have to know that you do the thing. You know what I mean? Whether you do it well or whether you do it
they just
bad,
gotta know.
Like, you know what I mean? It's gonna play out over time, but if no one knows, then it doesn't matter. You know what I mean?
Right.
But so going back in elementary school, so did you think you were going to be a singer, performer type thing doing that colors program? Like, what were you doing it for?
I guess I just liked... Cause I swore I was a break dancer when I was younger.
Yeah.
It was funny as shit. Yeah. And I hung around people
like
that would do
it. Like swinging on the floor type shit, yeah.
So it's like, I couldn't never do flips or nothing like that, but like I used to move a little bit. So I felt like that was like a cool thing, cause it was like a group thing that we were doing, you know? And then when I got older and like middle school and high school hit, they didn't have that program anymore because I moved. So it was like, there wasn't anything else musically intriguing to me at that time, so I kind of just strayed away from it. And then years and years passed, and then I dropped out of school, and then I got my heart broken like really bad. And then I noticed, like, you know, I was good at poetry, so I'm just like, let me try to write a song, because it's basically poetry on a beat. And that's when I started writing music.
You mentioned heartbreak, and if you don't mind, I want to go a little bit, because
go ahead.
Honestly, because like I think it's a very, like, pain is like a very
common.
Important part of the process. You feel me? And I think I really think it's the beginning of a lot of people's processes.
It is.
You mentioned it was kind of the beginning of yours. I know anyone that knows my story, I talk about it all the time. Heartbreak is what brought me to even like start creating content, start doing what I'm doing. You know what I mean?
Facts.
And so I kind of want to know, and just, you know, go as deep as you want to, but like, what were, like, how, okay. My question is, how did you dig yourself out of being in a very, very, very low state?
It wasn't easy at first, I'll say that. Like, I was going out, staying out late, doing drugs, like drinking, not eating, because I was so depressed. So I was distracting myself at first. And then when I started realizing that that wasn't the best coping mechanism, I tried to find something a little bit more healthier and creative, which is why I got into music. But it definitely was not easy.
Did you like literally tell yourself like, what I'm doing isn't serving me, let me do something else? Like, you know what I mean? Like,
I had other people tell me.
Yeah.
Cause it's like, I was so in my pain that I didn't really care about anything, not even myself. Like, it was like a routine thing. I woke up, went to work, smoked a shit ton, go out and party so I could distract myself and think about it, go to sleep, repeat. And then, like, I started losing weight, getting bags in my eyes, just like how I put in the song. Like, I was really looking sick, and I didn't notice that I was, because I wasn't really paying attention, because I didn't care. And then, like, my sister was crying to me one day. Like, she wrote to me, and, like, what she said to me kind of really hit home. And then my mom at that time, I was living with her, and I was in the basement, and I came home late one day, and she was, like, she had a talk with me, and she was just like, you need to get it the fuck together. Like, look at you. Like, you're fucking losing weight. You can barely see you type of thing. And I was just like, that's when I had to really check myself and be like, all right, you're never going to hear the end of it, number one. So you got to do something. But then it was just like, the other person didn't give a fuck. They're not in the state of mind that I'm in. They're not drinking theirself to forget about you. They're not fucking crying or skipping meals. They're doing fine. You get me? They don't give a fuck. So it's like, why tear yourself down or why let yourself sink that low for someone that doesn't care? And I think that's where the harsh reality hit in, was for me to admit that they didn't care, which at first was painful, but it was kind of like a fuel to get over it, because it's like, they don't care, why should I, type of thing.
Yeah.
So I think it starts off masking it until you actually believe that you don't care anymore.
Yeah, that's crazy, man, because I know exactly what you're talking about. You know what sucks. I mean? It's very interesting when you kind of take a step back and realize that you're only hurting yourself. Exactly. You know what I mean? Like, no one else is hurt by the situation but you. So, like, what the fuck are you doing?
At least not hurt at the level of intensity that you're
at. Yeah, for sure. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's, man, it's really crazy. So, okay, when you kind of realize you're at that lowest moments, what are some things that start to, what's like the light at the end of the tunnel that you start to see that kind of like, is like, okay, let me get started on turning this shit around? Or what are you even going towards, if you can think about it? Like, what were you trying to aim towards as far as like positive?
I wanted to be happy again. That's one thing. But I think another thing that helped was meeting new people, that if I told them the story, you know, they'd give me good advice, not just the advice that your friends are like, man, fuck that bitch, or fuck them. Yeah, like, let's get turned up. Like, that's not what I really want to hear.
Because what's interesting is, like, when you are going out, just like hanging out with your friends in that moment when you're trying to just forget about it, that's kind of what the narrative is. Like, exactly. I don't get another girl.
It's not necessarily their fault because they're trying to help you, but it's
like,
that's not the right way that I need it. Like, I need y'all to hear me out. I need you to let me vent. Even if you don't want to hear it, like, just let me talk about it. Like, instead of just saying fuck that, because then I have to pretend
that you don't care.
I don't care, just so you guys could be okay and have a good time. And it's just like, I'm having a shitty time because I'm still thinking about it. Facts. And I can't tell my friends about it because you guys are either fucking annoyed or you're just going to tell me, get the fuck over it. There's a ton of fish in the sea. And it's just like, y'all don't get it. But it's like, people love at different levels. So it's like, one day they'll feel that. Mm-hmm. They just probably haven't met that person that makes them feel like that yet. And it's just like, I hit that point. They didn't. So I had to not really blame them for trying to help me in the best way that they knew how, I guess.
Yeah. So, okay, if you can think about, I guess if you're getting on the road to recovery in a sense, you know what I'm saying? What's some of the first things that, I guess the first changes, I guess if you can think, in your life that you start to make to kind of dig you out of that?
Well, I could just say particularly for my journey, because everyone's different. I had, like I said, my coping mechanisms weren't healthy and stuff like that. So I started feeling sick. So it's like, okay, I didn't want to feel sick no more. So had to find healthy distractions. Got a diary, even though that sounds lame as shit, that really does help a fuck ton. Because in my opinion, like I said, the point of the diary is one day I might be really pissed off at somebody. And it could be somebody I care about. I'm not going to sit there and explode on them and then fuck up the relationship, as opposed to just, let me write all my thoughts out real quick, because I might not feel that way tomorrow or a week from now. You know, it might just be me, my ego just creating a scenario that don't even fucking exist. So it's like, certain things like that really do help. Surrounding yourself with people that, this is the hard part, because nobody wants to admit that they're surrounded by people that are not either beneficial to their growth and stuff like that, just because of history that they've had with them. So like, I used to have friends that I was friends with for more than 5 years, 6 years, and it took me a really long time to realize, even though I already knew that they weren't like my real friends, but we only stayed friends that long because we were friends in high school or middle school and stuff like that, and saw each other every day. But when I really sat back,
there was
back,
nothing really behind
the friendship. When I took myself out of it and I really looked at the friendship from how it started, everything that happened in there up until the end, I was just like, you were never my fucking friend.
Yeah, this
friend.
Wasn't really a friendship. This
you
was
were
just
never
like two
my
people
friend.
That just hung out a lot.
Exactly. Like, I was just somebody that, I guess you, that helped you feel good about yourself in a way.
Yeah.
You know, but
You seem to be very like self-aware and in tune with yourself. Mm-hmm. Is that something you've always been like, or did that take work?
It did take work. Because like
what
I said,
that look like?
Well, like when I was younger, I'd really despise just the thought of anything spiritual, because like, well, you know, when you're younger, like grandparents force you to go to church and you don't really want to go and stuff like that. And then me being like LGBT, I would always get looked at a certain way when I walked in the church. So it made me not like church, But then I started going on my spiritual side as like basically finding God on my own without church. Now, not to say that church is bad or anything like that. No, like that particular church just wasn't for me. And I ended up finding a good one that I guess helped spark me like trying to be in tune with myself, in tune with the universe, seeing how everything's connected as a collective and all that stuff. So it's like, that's why I try not to judge people too harshly, because we're all connected in some way. And it's like, you point a finger at somebody, three more pointing back at you.
Yeah.
So it's like the spiritual aspect of like being in tune and stuff, it took a lot of, how would I say, like mental turmoil and emotional turmoil to get to where I'm at. Like I feel like the universe literally stripped my mind and like beat me down to the core, but it was to turn me into somebody new, like fresh. I had to destroy who I was. And that's why everything was so painful, because I wasn't literally dying, but my old self was dying. All my old habits, all my old ways of thinking. So since it's leaving me, it's making a dramatic exit, which is why everything was so painful. Everything was so intense, so heightened, every emotion, every, and it was just like, fuck, when is it ever going to end?
Yeah.
But it's like, and the journey's still not over.
Yeah.
So it's like, there's still more painful shit that I'm going to go through, but it's just like based on from where I started up until now, continuing to the future, I can deal with it a lot better. And I feel like there was just one song I wrote, because that's the thing about my music too. Sometimes I don't really feel like it's me mm-hmm. when I look back and hear it. Like sometimes I feel like I'm giving messages to myself. It's like my higher self writing. Mm-hmm. So there was a verse that I did. The first verse was a human complaining to God basically about how life was shit. And the second verse was God responding. And there was a part that God said, don't you get that I love you more than they ever will? I'm trying to give you a heart the devil can never kill. So then I was just like, okay, that's why I'm going through the shit I'm going through, because the devil's going to probably try to use these same exact tactics of pain to try to break me. But little does he know, I've already went through this. So it's like, I can go through it. I'm not going to let it bring me down. I'm going to keep going no matter the times I get hit. So it was kind of like keeping that mentality, which is difficult to have because the lows are really low. But
yeah, for sure.
Keeping that mentality, reminding yourself, like, it's just all part of the test. It's all part of the plan. Like,
it's crazy, like you said, like, literally, as you were saying, your old self is dying. Mm-hmm. That's why it's so painful. Like, I feel that because I think about every...
And it doesn't want to leave either. So why it's going to hang on for dear life.
It's hanging on, bro. Like, that's why... So I think about when I was, like, in my worst state. You know what I mean? It was... It dragged, you know what I mean? Like it dragged. It was probably like a good 6, 7, 8 month transition from like being completely just like shit, just like drag, fucking zombie walking through my days to like at least being on some like, okay, I'm starting to see what I'm good at in life. You know what I mean? Like it was a long, slow, like really treacherous process. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And because, you know, everybody in your life knows you as one person. They're treating you as that person. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And they're very just not on board with the change, because no one's on board with change when
especially when it doesn't,
you know,
involve them being a part of the change.
Yeah.
They're
yeah.
not with it.
So like it definitely, like I feel that it just happens very, very, very slow. You know what I mean?
Definitely.
But something that I truly believe is that all of the most dramatic and most important changes in our life will happen because of something terrible. Like,
that's the thing. Yeah. I guess it's also like a, depending on what your journey is or where you're headed, I guess it's also a test of how bad do you want it? Because it's like, are you going to let this little thing stop you?
Yeah.
Or are you going to keep going?
Yeah.
So that,
it's funny,
I guess,
that you say little thing, but it's like anything.
Yeah. But I feel like it'll make you appreciate it much more when you finally get there.
Yeah, yeah, for sure. It's crazy because there was a caption that you had on one of your posts that really hit me, dog. And I don't know if it's a lyric of yours or just like a random quote, but it was something along the lines of like, things get hard. It was like things get hardest when
things
close.
Gonna be the hardest they can be when you start to get close, but discipline and faith are like a seed, gotta water them.
Yeah, that's exactly
that's
it, dog. That you rewrote that. Dog, that shit hit me because I'm like, that's kind of something that I feel like I'm going through now. Mm-hmm. You feel me? I was having a talk with my homie the other day about how it just seems like both of us, we were both kind of just like talking about this together about how It just seems like at this point in life, things are just becoming so, so, so fucking hard. You know what I'm saying? And it's like, dog, I thought I did all the hard work just to get to this point. You know what I mean? Like to the point where I was like, so yo, like I can start to, I was like, I can start to feel things are shifting in the sense of like, in the way that I want them to. I'm starting to feel like, okay, the things that I manifested 3 years ago are starting to come into pass, right?
Right.
And but also like all these other things are kind of like crumbling, and I'm trying to like keep the positive mindset, but I can't act like I'm not bothered by some of the things that have been happening in other parts of my life, right? Yeah. And we were just talking about like, damn, bro, like it's crazy that like I feel like I'm winning the most I ever have in my life, but I also feel like these L's that I'm taking are super significant. You feel me? So like I feel like that's what I like that line really hit me, because it's like things are the hardest that they've ever been, but it's like I still have to stay disciplined in the sense of like working on my videos every day, working on my craft every day, and then also have that faith that like there's still more for me out there. You feel me? Like this isn't it. Like,
but I feel like that's how you know that you're close. That's why I wrote that lyric, because it's just like, if you know that, because it's that saying of like the best part about being at the bottom is that there's nowhere else to go.
No, you can't go farther down.
So it's like if you feel like you're hitting rock bottom, whatever, then you're about to be on your way up. You know, so it's just like, but it's like them fucking lows, man. Yeah. It's not hypnotizing, but it can
demoralizing.
Basically, like convince you that it's the end of it all, whatever, when it's really not. So like it can manipulate you, I guess, in a way to make you believe that this is the worst fucking time of your life, or like shit is never gonna get better, and it's just like you might as well give up. It's just like, no, that's like your emotions can lie to you sometimes.
For sure. You know what? I want to ask you an interesting question. What does your self-talk sound like? Like what are some of the things that you say to yourself when you are feeling down? Like today, not today, but like in this day and age where you are in a better place mentally than you were before. But like we said, we still inevitably have those days and those moments when we're still just like, damn, things aren't going so well. What do you say to yourself in those moments?
I mean, I have breakdowns before I actually get to talk to myself.
I bet. No, that's crazy. So it's like the first for me is like I just like, let me just go through it, right?
Let me just go through it. And it's like, so it's like I have that moment where I don't necessarily cry like all the time, but it's like, all right, if depending on how heavy the turmoil is, I'll go into my emotional state first. I'll be crying. I'll be by myself. Some people could ask what's wrong, but basically, like depending on the situation, I'll explain it or not. I'll be like, I gotta handle this by myself.
Yeah, for sure.
So it's like that's how it starts, and then that's when the diary kicks in. I'll express how I really want to express it, and then after that I'm like, all right, a day will pass, 2 days will pass, I'll reread what I wrote, see if I still feel that way, why I felt that way, what triggered me to feel that way. And then it's like I'm at that point in my life where when something happens to me, I have to go into my mind, even to when I was little, and figure out how this all led up to this moment, and why I react in these ways, and how could this situation have been prevented if I would have done something different or whatever. Because it's like certain things we do is because we get triggered from something. We don't even know it's a trigger.
For sure.
And that's why we react a certain way, not knowing that there's a pattern going on. So it's like I caught myself in a pattern. And it got to a point I had to admit to myself, like, you're addicted to pain, bitch. You've been so sad for so long that you don't allow yourself to be happy without feeling guilty, because you feel like you don't deserve it. And I'm still kind of battling that in my mind, because like I said, I've been like so depressed and so like for so long and always been going through some shit that I feel like that's the norm for me. So when something good happens to me, I'm always getting anxiety, because I'm like, damn, is it gonna end? Like, it'll probably be bad or whatever.
Something bad's on the horizon.
Exactly. I can never enjoy it without overthinking it. So then I started catching myself, like, because the power of the thought can manifest it too. So I'm like, my thoughts could play a part in why things always go the same way, because it's like you expect it to be that way before it even happens. So I had to cut out a lot of expectations of shit always going bad. There's been times I've actually looked at myself in the mirror, like in my eyes while I've been crying, and I've apologized to myself. Like I have to talk to myself sometimes and be like, look, it's okay. We're going to be okay. I'm sorry. I've been neglecting you. I haven't been paying attention to you. Or like if I'm so depressed that I starve, I have to apologize to myself in the mirror. Like, I'm so sorry, because my inner child, I guess you would say, is just like, they have so much more hope and potential for me that I keep, just because of being sad, I neglect it. And it's like disrespect to that.
Yeah.
You get me? So it's like, I think it goes back to the discipline factor of like, you really, not everybody can admit that they're the problem sometimes. Yeah. And I had to admit to myself in certain situations that I was the problem. I couldn't just keep pointing my finger at everybody else.
Yeah.
And that's when things started to get better, because now when I could finally admit when I fuck up and stuff like that, that's when I was able to see the people around me and it's like who I should be around, who I shouldn't be around, who was detrimental to my growth and who wasn't. And I think that's how.
That's very interesting to me, because and you said something about accountability earlier. Mm-hmm. And to me, accountability is the most important thing, man. When I think about the trajectory of my life, like literally the moment I realized that my life is mine and I need to be responsible for anything that happens in it. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, I lived the first like 25 years of my life kind of just doing what my parents said. And then when things went bad, be like, oh, well, it's because they told me, you know what I mean? And just be blaming them. I'm just like, dog, like, yeah, they tell me to do shit, but it's up to me to say yes or no. Like, exactly. Who the fuck am I? You know what I'm saying? Like, who am I blaming? So like, but the fucking key in that is when you hold yourself responsible for the good things and the bad things, you can start to change the things that you don't like, and you can keep the things that you do like consistent. You feel me?
Yeah.
So literally in those moments of being sad or whatever, I'd be like, well, why do I feel this way? And let's just say I blame someone else. Well, I'm like, well, why is this person in my life? Or why does this person have such a heavy say in my life that they can control my emotions? You know what I mean? All that type of shit. Like it starts like accountability is such a broad thing, but like, I think it boils down to different levels of that will lead you to like a life of a happier life, I guess. You know what I mean? It starts with looking at yourself in the mirror and just like blaming yourself for everything that's wrong, so that you can then begin to make the changes and not like just say, well, oh, it's this person's fault, and then think that person will change. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's not how it works. You feel me? But I want to get back into the music a little bit.
Okay.
When did you feel like, so you said it started off as a hobby, right? And I know we talked a little bit earlier about like when you kind of started to put your foot on the gas on it, but like I want to know more about like what that shift looked like. Like what, like when you say it was a hobby, was it like you're just going and recording once a month, or like what did it look like from going from making music as a hobby? Because I used to make music too, and like as a hobby, I feel like I was making it more than when I told myself I was taking it seriously.
Exactly. Just
because it really was fun. You know what I mean? So like, what did it look like for you when you're making music as a hobby, and then as you go on to taking it more seriously?
So I think for like my 19th birthday, I think it was my 19th birthday or 18th birthday, I went to Miami. My grandfather had bought me an iPad, and I downloaded GarageBand on there, and that's how I basically would record my music. So it was like, at first I wasn't really going to studios. I was recording myself on the iPad all the time, any song that I ever wanted to do. And the quality wasn't that great, but lyrically, I always had it.
Mm-hmm.
Lyrically, it was always there.
Could you always sing too? Because I feel like you could sing.
Yeah, I was just scared to.
Yeah, you just wouldn't sing.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
I was just really timid, and I wasn't that confident in my voice. Like, I'm not 100% now even confident in my voice, but I have really gotten better and improved from how I first started singing up until now. Like, now I could flutter my voice on demand. Before, I was too scared to even sing that loud. But so it started with the iPad, being in my room, just recording shit. It got to the point that I was recording all the time that my mom's husband would have to text my mom while she's at work telling me to be quiet downstairs because he was trying to sleep before he had to go to work.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd just be like, all right, whatever. You guys don't support me.
You're killing my dream.
Like, right. But and then after that, I met my cousin's artist, Fame Reek and Dutch Capital. We went over to their house. They had an in-house studio. That's when I started making real music, like real songs in a studio. And then from there, like, I wasn't making as much music, but I was. But then I started getting my ear a lot heavier. So I didn't like certain ways that I sounded. Quality and stuff started playing a role. So I always wanted to get better. But then after that, I was a part of the little music group stuff, so they basically helped a lot. as far as my confidence of being in the studio and stuff like that. And then when I decided I really wanted to take it serious, I had to really look at everything in a way of like, all right, this is how it starts. Who's going? Who's not? Because you're not gonna, I personally don't want to be an underground artist forever. I don't want to be on the level of like everybody in the city knows me and stuff and I'm famous here, but anywhere else nobody knows who the fuck I am.
You want to be like,
I want to be global. On Drake's level or yeah. maybe even Surprise's level, because like mm-hmm. I said, there's people that start off saying shit like that and people look at them like you're fucking crazy until they actually do it. Mm-hmm. Like, there was that line that Drake said. He was like, she said, I'll never be as big as Trey Songz. Boy, was she wrong.
Straight shit up, like that. Straight up, yeah.
So it's like, I kind of feel like that. I always tell myself, like, I am going to be the next big, big thing. Like, possibly bigger than Drake because of the simple fact I'm a female. And there's not really many female artists that do it this way mm-hmm. because they're always, like, talking sexually in their music or rapping about pussy or stuff like that, and they cannot really do both rapping and singing and doing in Spanish and doing this, like, so it's like I know I have something different. It's not mm-hmm. that I'm better, but I'm just different.
Yeah,
so that mentality started coming into my mind, and then I had to really put myself on that mental of like it's just difficult because it's like fuck, there's so much shit and there's not really one way to put it because everyone's journey is different. But my particular journey, I guess you could just say that I had to be honest with myself, starting with the people that I was surrounding myself with. And a lot of people feel entitled to you because they helped you, mm-hmm. but they don't respect you enough to change, to go along with you.
Yeah, like they got you from, they helped you yeah, they from try A to, to B. But
and they, then they try to... give you that mentality like who the fuck do you think you is type yeah. of shit
when you're going you know? From like B to C to C mm-hmm. to D to D to, yeah mm-hmm.
so after that transition, it was like I started having to, like, when I went to go talk to labels and stuff, certain requirements that they wanted, this, that, third, that's when music started becoming like, all right, it's not that I don't like it, but it's mm-hmm. like it's not as fulfilling and fun as it used to be, because somebody always wants to critique it now. Somebody always wants you to do this. Somebody always wants you to do this. And it's just like, bro, when I started
taking
this,
art out of it.
Yeah. And it's just like, when I started this, I did it because I loved to do it. I was expressing myself in exactly the way I needed to express it. I wasn't looking for people to tell me like, yo, this sucks. You need to do this to get this. And I was just like, bro, I just wanted to do it. Whoever yeah, listens, listens. Up, whoever doesn't, oh I don't God, care.
That's so
like, I'm the type, I'll put out fucking 3-4 songs in a week if I want to. Yeah. I don't give a fuck how yeah. many plays you get. Yeah. I wanted to put it out because I knew it was a fire ass song and somebody's going to hear it and they're going to like it.
Yeah.
Type of shit. But it's like now, because I want to be a career artist, you have to care about those things. You have to care about the numbers. You have to care about when you post it, how you post it, how you fucking promote it, all that stuff. And it's just like, I'm really starting to not like my job.
Yeah.
Because it's a job now.
Yeah,
I was
yeah.
doing it because it was my passion. Mm-hmm. It was my diary. It was just like a way to be me. But now it's just like, I don't know.
Man, you know what's crazy? I feel like this is something that we can connect on, honestly, because I felt that shift too. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I felt the shift of when filmmaking and videography was like a passion and a hobby to when, okay, this is expected out of me on a professional level.
And all like, the expectations are what kill it. And it's just
and it's like, I got to do certain things like how people want them because like that's how they want it and this is for them.
As opposed to like, just and it's like
everything
that
I did
me.
Prior was for me. And what's crazy is like, because even as I'm building my career, it's like, I want to build the career that I want to live. You feel
definitely,
me?
Definitely, definitely.
So in having, but again, you know, you got to make money to fucking eat. You know what I mean? So it's like, you got to do the thing. Like that's something that I just grapple with every fucking day. It's like passion or business. You know what I mean? Like, what is it?
But see, that's the thing where I feel like I'm the rebel in this situation, because everybody's like, well, sometimes you got to do things you don't want to do to get to where you get. And 100%. I'm just like, I'm that motherfucker that's like, no, you don't have to. And I will make you like, there's probably other ways to do it difficult longer, mm-hmm. but you don't have to fucking do it this
way. No, that's a fact. You said it right. Like, you can do it your way if you're more patient, if you're willing to drag it out a little longer. And yeah, I am too. 100%.
Based off the journey that I've had so far, I am losing my patience. I can say that. Mm-hmm. And that's bad. But I am, just based off the simple fact, because it's also like, as an artist, from the artist perspective, it's difficult to see, like, you're not supposed to always compare yourself to anybody. And that, I guess, when certain people make it and you're just like, what the fuck do they have that I don't,
yeah, type of shit.
Because there's certain rappers on the radio and stuff, and I'll listen, I'll be like, what in the fuck is this, bro?
Same shit.
And then it makes you question yourself, like, I can write better than that, and I still haven't blown. What the fuck? So it's like, it makes you self-conscious. Like, you start thinking about shit you don't really need to fucking think about just because you're comparing yourself to everybody else's success. And that's why I'm like, when labels try to fucking tell you that you have to have these things, like, one way doesn't work for everybody, clearly.
Yeah.
Because if that was the case, everybody would be blowing the fuck up.
And everybody would be, I mean, people do this, don't get me wrong.
Right.
But it's like, everybody, the people that be blowing up, it's like, it's usually something that's a little bit different. You know what I mean? A little bit different.
I just feel like people are too scared to break the rules.
Yeah. And what's crazy is, in this day and age, like, the things that, like, really blow up and go viral, it's the thing that, it's usually for a negative reason.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? Like, about the Catch Me Outside girl. Like, that was not, that was a viral moment that was, like, very frowned upon.
But
this is what
blew me, because I had a moment where, like, I'm not going to say exactly who, but, like, I had met with a label, right? And in my mind, they're demanding all these numbers and to do this, you know, in order for you to, because they're like, the talent is definitely there, but, you know, you got to grow your fan base, you got to do this. And in my mind, I'm like, that bitch, no offense, that bitch was not even talented. She wasn't a rapper. Y'all turned her into that because y'all saw how much attention she got. And it's just like, what are y'all talking about? Yeah. Somebody must be fucking lying.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it's like, that's not what y'all really want. Why are y'all making it hard on the real artists? Mm-hmm. And y'all are signing deals for people that don't have the talent. They just have the numbers. That's why you're always going to be in search for the next big thing, because it's not about quality.
Well, that's the thing. I think that's why, honestly, like, labels get a bad rap, because it's not, they don't necessarily care. Like, they're a business. They mm-hmm. do care about the numbers because of that. They're trying to sell as many records as possible. That's why they'll take someone who can get a lot of attention mm-hmm. and then just throw them on some music. You know what I'm saying? Like, honestly,
it's
I don't think the Catch Me Outside girl was gonna make music unless she wasn't as super popular as she is. You know what I'm saying?
One, like, a good one fire song that she did with Tory Lanez, but I know she didn't write that.
That's what I'm saying. Like, I'm not saying she can't make a fire song.
Right.
Anyone can make a fire song. But it's very interesting too, because, like, something that I see that's like a pattern is some of these people who get famous on social media, mm-hmm. the first thing that they do to monetize is make a song and sell it on iTunes. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's
right.
The first
thing. They always want to go the route of being
a
rapper.
Either you
or
make
singer.
A song or you make a t-shirt. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's what you do with an audience when you amass one. So, like, sometimes when these people amass, like, an unexpected audience, like, they just literally were living their life, did something that was super funny or super stupid, and now they're viral, and they're just trying to keep up the momentum by, like, making music to keep, you know what I mean? Like, let me make something that somebody will buy. Mm. It's a song or it's a t-shirt. You know what I mean? So it's very, so I think those labels, I don't know, man. I think people who make good music, so, because the way I think about music from a business standpoint,
mm-hmm.
I think, you know, if you're someone, like, as talented as you are, I feel like all you would have to do is just, like, continue to make your, you know what I'm saying, do your craft, get mm-hmm. better at it, but just, like, amass your fan base, you know what I'm saying? Like,
right.
Amass that, and then you can, like, you have that, you made that, you know what right. I mean? Like, I feel like when people go to labels and stuff like that don't already have the fan base, because there's one of two ways. You can have the fan base and then you have more of the leverage, because mm-hmm. it's like, okay, well, what can y'all do for me type shit?
Right.
Or it's like, okay, you have a look that we can turn into something that can get attention. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, those industry plants that they be talking about.
Right.
You know what I mean? So, like, that's, but either way, the talent doesn't have to necessarily be there. What they're looking for is, do you get people to rally behind you or mm-hmm. with you or because of you? Like, whatever it is, like, do you get people? Can you get people into a stadium? Can you get people into a record store to buy your shit? Or record store. that sounds how old I am.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? But fucking, like, you know what I mean? But, like, I feel like that's what that is. You know what I mean? So, yeah. I mean, but how do you think about that? Like, how do you think about where you want to take your career? I know you said you want to be a global star, but, like, how do you feel like you'll get there?
Honestly, at this point, I have no idea.
Yeah.
And it's not in a sense of me being lost. It's just more so of the factor that there's so many rules and regulations of to how this shit goes. It's just like, I don't know which way I'm gonna make it. I don't know if I'm gonna make it from getting signed. I don't know if I'm gonna make it from staying independent, just working my ass off. I don't know. Because at this point, it's like, it could go either way. But it's like, it's more so the fact that I, like I said, my patience for this is getting, like, I don't want to get to the point where I say I'm done with music before I even get there mm-hmm. because of all the bullshit that has happened between it. Because everyone's like, oh my God, like, don't give up. You're so, and it's just like, I don't want to. That's what I don't understand. I don't want to, but it's the shit that is going on, how difficult it is to get there for people like myself that really love to do this shit as opposed to people that just want fame and money and they blow up quicker yeah. like than anything else. And it's just like, it's soul crushing, bro, yeah, to see nah, that shit. It yeah. is, and it just, it makes you want to say, fuck this.
Yeah. It's funny, man, because I have this conversation. I know a lot of musicians and I have this conversation pretty often mm-hmm. where it's like, I don't want to say you have to choose one or the other. That's not what I'm trying to say. Mm-hmm. But I feel like to a certain degree, you have to at least have an understanding that there is a choice there. Right. You know what I mean? There is a choice to be made there. Like being super famous and being a super respected and talented musician are not mutually exclusive. You know what I'm saying? Like you might have to go after one and forget the other and just hope that the other comes. You know what I mean? Like if you like really dig into your craft, you know what I'm saying? The fame may or may not ever come, you know what I'm saying? Right. But like, you would have to like have, you would have to be comfortable with that. Like, I think about the same thing that I'm trying to do with like media and entertainment. Like, I love to make content. I love to shoot. I love to edit. I love the process of it. You know what mm-hmm. I'm saying? My goal is to, you know what I'm saying, be a filmmaker and like make movies. Right. Whether people actually like watch the movies or not, I don't know. You know what I'm saying? I just want to know. I just want to make them. You feel me? But I also want to reach a certain level of like success and fame that I'm like wealthy off of this shit. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like wealthy, not just like
exactly
rich or like well off. I want to amass a certain amount of wealth. You know what I mean? But I'm also comfortable with like knowing that I may not do that through making movies. You know what I'm saying? I may have to do that through like, you know what I'm saying, my other, like other things, you know what I'm saying? I may have to like find other ways to make money to like amass that wealth. You know what I mean? Because what I run into is kind of like what you're saying is like, when you say, like when you want to do your thing, it's hard to just be able to do the thing without like feeding into all the bullshit that mm-hmm. brings in the money. You know mm-hmm. what I mean? Mm-hmm. So like, I don't know. That's something that I grapple with all the time.
Yeah, so do I. That's why I'm like, I don't want to have to do those. Like sometimes I'll find myself, like even when it comes to music, I'll find myself looking at beats that I usually wouldn't look at, but I know that that's the thing now, that's what's popping, that's what's, so like maybe I should try to make a song like that. But it's just like I gotta talk myself out, like, Jay, no, like, you know that's not you. Yeah. Even though that's what they want, fuck that. Because once you finally get to where you gotta get, they're gonna hear you, and those that are really meant to fuck with you are gonna ride with you. And yeah, it's gonna take some time, but right now, I feel like it's because of the fact that the music industry is so saturated with all this bullshit music mm-hmm. that mainly the youth loves. So it's like, it's kind of hard to get their attention now because they think motherfuckers like J. Cole suck. And they think that.
That's, yeah, that's crazy.
That's why I was like, yeah. I saw a tweet of someone said that Young Thug was better than J. Cole.
Yeah.
And it's no disrespect to either of them.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's just like, one, they're not in the same bracket. So you cannot even compare them. Yeah. You can't. You yeah. just cannot. Young Thug is good at what he do. J. Cole's good at, but if we talking lyrical, my guy, J. Cole got that shit hands down.
Yeah.
Hands down.
Yeah. But I also don't even think that's what Young Thug is trying to be. You know
He's
what I
not.
Mean? So it's very, like, kind of like what we said, like, people just want to put people in boxes. You know what I'm saying? It's just
there
like,
you go.
I don't like, yeah, like all, and you used to hear that a lot when like mumble rap first came mm-hmm. onto the scene or whatever. You would hear all these people talking about how like all these mumble rappers are trash and they don't care compared to these other people. And it's like, dog, I don't think they're trying to, you know, it's like, I don't think they're trying to compare to like,
that's where it kind of frustrates it because they don't understand the impact that music has on mm-hmm, people. Mm-hmm. Like whenever you're feeling a certain way, the first thing people want to do is go listen to music. If you angry or no, if you're sad, you're going to listen to some shit that's going to emphasize your sadness. Mm-hmm. If you're fucking happy and shit about to go turn up, you're going to listen to some songs that are going to make you hype before you get to the fucking party. Mm-hmm. Music is a very powerful thing. And they don't understand that, like, when I get it because it's a hip hop thing, but it's like when you keep talking about, when you glorifying all the drugs and all the shit and the shooting and shit like that, you can't sit here and start getting mad at motherfuckers that are in the streets doing these things or act like you have sympathy for the people that are dying off of these drugs. You yeah. are literally promoting that shit yeah. for your fans. Your fans, the way I look at it, they're going to eventually be like your kids. That's your family. That's your kids. You got to take care of your kids. So you want the best for your kids. So it's like, that's what I think about when I reflect on my music. Like, yeah, I have a lot of sass on stuff, but if you really pay attention, it's not about glorifying the sadness. It's more about trying to find hope in the sadness, letting you know, like, this is not going to stay this way or whatever, you know, shit like that. But it's like, so that's why I'm just like, it blows me with that because, like, for example, even today, like, Juice WRLD died. That was shocking as fuck.
Yo, that's crazy.
And I got really sad because I thought about the song that he made about XXXTentacion and Lil Peep and stuff like that. And they all, I don't know how he died. I think he died of a seizure, but everyone else, like, it was drugs and stuff like that. And then when I'm like, guys, like, all of y'all fucking glorify this shit in your songs.
Yeah.
You can't be upset when your man's died about it, because you had the power to tell him to stop.
Yeah.
Or you had the power to be the first one to lead that way of stopping, and they will follow. But it's just like, I'm not in the industry like there, so it's like, I don't know how much drugs and shit they're surrounded by. That shit must be like so easy to get. So it's like, coming from someone that used to have nothing, and then you have everything now, I could see why they indulge so much in everything. Yeah. But it's like, when you see what's really going on in the world, and you see the platform that you have, and you're using it for that, as opposed to making differences, that's why I'm just like, you're not getting it. Yeah. You're not understanding the gift that you truly have, as opposed to you just being wealthy and rich. It's not about that.
Yeah, man, I really appreciate you for coming through, doing this.
I appreciate you for having me.
Yeah, any last things you want to sign off with?
If anybody's going through some difficult times right now, especially because it's the holiday season, and that seasonal depression really does kick
for
in.
For sure. That's really a thing. What's crazy is that's really a thing. I feel like everybody in my close circle that I've been talking to has just been going through something.
I think it's easy for seasonal depression to kick in just because of the fact it's the time where everyone gets together and be with people they quote unquote love and stuff like that. And there's people that don't really have that and they don't want to admit that they don't have that. So they want to just put on a facade or whatever.
But you start to feel it.
Yeah,
you start
they
to feel it
feel
when
it.
Like people are so gathering, like, and you're
and
not.
And it also
at the
goes
gatherings.
With not being honest with yourself, which is why a part of why depression is a thing, because nobody wants to be honest with themselves, because they always have to have a mask on for somebody else. So if anybody out there is feeling the blues, one, go check out my music, because I promise it'll help. It's gonna be okay. And I know everybody says that, and most of us get tired of hearing that shit, because they're like, when the fuck is it going to be okay? Because it's not okay right now. It's probably not going to be okay tomorrow, but it will be okay as long as you do not give up. So just don't give up, no matter how hard you think it is or how hard it may be. It's not impossible.